Hi, good morning. So I welcome you all to this small session on amendments for a CA final direct taxes and international taxation, that is paper 7 as well as paper 6C. This video is for both old and new syllabus students. So for old syllabus students, only paper number 7, and for new syllabus students, paper number 7 and 6C. There are not many amendments for November 2020 exam, and if you download the statutory update, so I request you that you please download this. It is available on institute's website, plus on our website also it is uploaded in free notes part. So please download that, and now let's start with this. So I think you should be downloading and taking a printout, but almost we can say 50% of the amendments are those which were already there for May 2020 exam. So why they have reproduced, I really don't know, but here we'll focus on the only new changes which have happened. There are some changes which are already made, and we have covered in our this revision series. So as and when we come to that part, I will tell you that which lecture you have to watch for that purpose. Anyways, those who have already watched the lectures multiple times, you might be already aware that yes, this was already there. So when this statutory update was out, many students asked that why this statutory update is given, because there are hardly any changes in DT. Same for IDT also. In IDT tomorrow I'll be providing you the amendments relating to IDT. So there also many things which were already there for May 2020 exam in the statutory update for May 2020 exam, same has been repeated. So let's start with the first amendment. This is a new one, specified securities for section 47 7 AB. So what is 47 7 AB? So in case, this is applicable in case of non-residents. So if a non-resident transfers specified assets, so what are those assets? Bond or GDRs or rupee denominated bonds of an Indian company or derivatives, then it is transferred by a non-resident where it is transferred on a recognized stock exchange located in IFSC. IFSC is International Financial Service Center. So they are setting up IFSC in Gandhinagar, which is in Gujarat, near Ahmedabad. Gandhinagar is the capital city of Gujarat. So they are setting up IFSC there. So in that IFSC, if there is a stock exchange, recognized stock exchange, and on that, if a non-resident transfers which assets, either bonds or debentures, referred to in 115 AC, so bonds or bonds and GDR, so those bonds are foreign currency convertible bonds, or rupee denominated bonds of Indian company, or derivative is transferred and the consideration is received in foreign exchange, then that transfer is not taxed. And this is specifically section 47 7 AB applicable for only non-resident. Non-resident doing transfer of these assets, receiving consideration in foreign currency, and the transaction occurs in a recognized stock exchange in IFSC. All these conditions have to be fulfilled. Now, they have also added, in addition to these securities, they have also added other notified securities. So which are the notified securities? So as per notification 16/2020, these are also notified securities, which means if they are transferred by a non-resident, consideration is received in foreign exchange, and where they have been transferred, in a recognized stock exchange which is located in IFSC, then capital gain won't arise. So which are those specified securities? Foreign currency denominated bond. So in 47 section, they have given rupee denominated bond, means the bond is denominated in rupees. Here the notified one is foreign currency denominated bond, means the bond is issued in foreign currency. Units of mutual fund, units of business trust, foreign currency denominated equity share of a company, and unit of alternative investment fund. So if these assets are transferred on a recognized stock exchange in IFSC by a non-resident and the consideration is received in foreign currency, then no capital gain would arise. And other things, so it should be as per the requirements of SEBI or IFSC authority, under that IFSC Authority Act 2019. That is the first amendment, a genuine amendment we can say. Next is also important. So this amendment is from the chapter capital gains. Either capital gains or in international taxation also, there is one part of capital gain. So this is common for paper 7 and 60 both. Next one is relating to this 56-10. This is also a genuine amendment, a new amendment, not a repeated one. So 56-10 is gift. There are 5 categories of gift, like gift of money, monetary gift. If it exceeds 50,000, then entirely taxable. Then second one was immovable property gift. So if it is received free and SDV exceeds 50,000, then entire SDV taxable. And if it is received for low, or it is purchased for lower value, and the difference between stamp duty value and purchase price exceeds 50,000 or 5% of sale consideration, which are higher, then the difference would be taxed. And for movable property also received free and FMV exceeds 50,000, then that FMV would be taxed. And if it is purchased below the FMV and the difference exceeds only 50,000, then difference would be taxable. For movable property gift, this 5% point won't apply. Now there are some circumstances where gift provisions won't apply, like gift received from relatives, then gift on marriage. There they have given one more point added this year, is that in case of specified transaction or notified transactions, gift provisions will not apply. So they have notified one transaction for November 2020 exam, and for next May 2021 exam there are two more which are not there for your exam. So only one transaction has been notified where gift provisions will not apply. So what is that transaction where gift provisions will not apply? Now, if you are aware that in the month of January 2020, Delhi elections were held. So just before the Delhi elections, if you are analyzing or if you are into all this politics and news, so you might be aware that our central government made a declaration that all the unauthorized houses in Delhi are now authorized. So actually they were not unauthorized as such. In the sense, the people who were staying in those houses had paid for that, but the houses were not transferred in their name. See, let's say there is Mr. A staying in a house. It was not transferred in his name. And now, after the central government approved, the houses were now transferred in their name. So are they paying anything now? No, they're not paying anything, but the house is being transferred in their name. Okay. So imagine that I'm staying in a house. I'm having the possession of the house and the ownership is transferred to me and I'm not paying anything. So ideally, I'm getting it free, so stamp duty value should be taxed. But here specifically given that in such case, provisions of section 56-10 won't apply, it won't be taxed. So what is given here? As per rule 11 UAC, to provide that provisions of section 56-10 shall not apply to any immovable property, being land or building or both, received by resident of unauthorized colony. Earlier, those were unauthorized colony in NCT, that is National Capital Territory of Delhi. Okay, now NCR is also there. NCR means Delhi and adjoining suburbs, like Delhi, Gurugram, Faridabad, and all this is NCR. But this is not NCR. This exemption is only for NCT, that is National Capital Territory of Delhi. So if I am a resident of that unauthorized colony and I receive the immovable property where central government by notification and official gazette regularize the transactions of such immovable property based on latest power of attorney, agreement to sell, will, possession letter and other documents, including documents evidencing payment of consideration for conferring or recognizing right of ownership or transfer or mortgage in relation regard to such immovable property in favor of resident. So the property is transferred, the ownership is transferred to that resident, and now that unauthorized colony becomes regularized. So it is like immovable property received free of cost. In that case, gift provisions will not apply. Got it? So thousands of people regularize their houses. And who is a resident? Person having physical possession of the property. So that person is staying there, but he is not having the ownership, and now he is getting the ownership. So earlier he was called as illegal, but now it becomes legal. On the basis of registered sale deed or latest set of power of attorney, agreement, etc., etc., and includes legal heirs, but does not include tenant, licensee or permissive user. So on the basis of some sale deed which is not yet recognized, I am having the possession. I give it on the rent to someone, to a tenant. So in that case, will tenant be considered as resident? No. The person having physical possession of the property and his legal heirs will be the resident and not tenant, license or permitted user. Permitted user means we have allowed that other person to stay, but that does not mean he becomes a resident. And unauthorized colony means colony or development comprising of contiguous area where no permission has been obtained for approval of layout plan or building plans and has been identified for regularization as per this notification. So there were many colonies in Delhi where, if you have done any research or if you have done some audit relating to builders, for construction you require a layout plan and it has to be approved. So in these cases it was not approved, that's why they were illegal. But these people had genuinely paid amount, so they were not like just they have constructed anywhere and they have started living. They have paid, but the layout plan was not sanctioned and all, and now it is regularized, so provisions of gift will not apply. Okay, now I told you that there are many amendments here where it is be repeated. So this chapter 12 assessment of various entities, this 115 BAB and BAA, it was there for May 2020 exam also. So this entire thing is repeated. I don't know why they have given here. And this annexure 2, rates of surcharge, that is relating to that enhanced surcharge won't apply for LTCG. So two things, that 115 BAA and BAB and this enhanced surcharge we have already covered. This and with examples we have already covered in one YouTube video. So if you go on our YouTube channel, so you can check up in the this DT CA final DT rapid revision May November 2020. In that there is video number 13. 115, so what is that video number 13 heading? Section 115 BAA, BAB and enhanced surcharge. So this is already covered. So almost 54 minutes video is there, everything is covered, please watch that. So I'm not repeating again something which is already available. Then chapter number 13 is charitable trusts, religious trusts. So this is basically relating to that 11.5, sorry. So in case of 11 charitable trust, we can apply the income for accumulation. Means I'll reword it. The income can be accumulated and can be accumulated for 5 years. In that case, whenever it is accumulated, it has to be deposited in section 11.5 modes. So there is a big list of 11.5 modes. So they have notified one that in which mode you can invest. CBDT has wide notification. This is notification 15/2020. Please remember, notification number, circular number, you need not remember. What you need to remember is the whatever is the content of that. CBDT has, okay, but sometimes some notifications are important. Like in case of GST, there is a notification due to which that advances are not taxed relating to goods. That notification number is important. So those who have our practice book, after every chapter I've given list of sections. So there some important notification numbers are also given. So please go through that. Let's come back to this. So what is covered under 11.5? Investment made by a person authorized under section 4 of Payment and Settlement Act 2017 in equity shares, share capital or bonds or debentures of a company which is engaged in operation of retail payment system or digital payment settlement or similar activities in India and abroad and is approved by RBI for this purpose and in which at least 51% of the equity shares are held by National Payments Corporation of India. So what is given here? You can purchase, the charitable trust can purchase equity shares, bonds or debentures of a company. Which company? Which is into retail payment system. Now everything is digital. So if the company is into digital payments and 51% of the equity shares of that company are held by National Payment Corporation of India, then in that case we can invest. So as a charitable trust, I have to keep that money in 11.5 modes. So this can be one of the 11.5 modes. Got it? So up till now, how many amendments we have done? First amendment was relating to this 47.7AB. So you can just write down summary. Whenever I am discussing, whatever I have told, you can write a summary on your own. Second one is relating to 56 to 10. Then this is repeated. Then third one is relating to this 11.5. Next one is and 194N. So this is a section where that if cash withdrawal is made from banks in excess of 1 crore, then TDS applies. So there is a press release relating to this. So this is repeated. So this was there for May 2020 also exam. So in TDS, so you can go through the TDS revision video. In that, this press release, I have covered 2-3 cases also relating to this press release, that this section was applicable from 1st September 19. So what if the cash is withdrawn before that or after that? 2-3 examples also I have covered in the revision videos. Plus, there are some transactions where this section is not applicable, like this authorized dealer, money changer, etc. So this is also covered. And this ATM, etc. And here they have given the provisions that you have to deposit by 30 days. So those provisions are also same. So they have just reproduced the entire thing. Otherwise, it is same. There is no change. So this is covered under TDS. Next one is Aadhaar. So Aadhaar linking. As you are aware that Aadhaar and PAN has to be linked. So if you have filed any returns online, so every time you open, you log in, there is a pop-up window that link Aadhaar to PAN. If it is already linked, then no issue. So for that, there is section 139AA. And if you don't link Aadhaar to PAN, then PAN would become ineffective. So for example, if today is the last day, I don't link. So from tomorrow, it will become ineffective. After 10 days, if I link it, then from that day, PAN would become effective. So there should be some timeline for that. So there was a timeline which kept on being extended. And the latest time limit to do that is 31st March 2021. So by 31st March 2021, all PAN and Aadhaar have to be linked. So it went on, there were a lot of notifications like 30th September, 31st December 19, then 31st March 2020 and subsequently 31st March 21. Okay, now next two amendments are important. These are fresh amendments. Prescribe electronic modes. So there is 269SU. So what is 269SU? This is covered in penalties chapter. So if I am carrying out business and my turnover exceeds 50 crores in the last year, turnover, sale, total turnover, gross receipts, etc. exceeds 50 crores. This is only for business in the preceding year. Then I have to give a facility to my customers to make payment in prescribed electronic modes. And in addition to that, other electronic modes. So prescribed electronic modes also we are going to study, and other electronic modes also. So what are the other electronic modes they have notified as per section 269SU? So if my turnover, let's say I'm running a e-commerce platform and my turnover of last year is 60 crores, then when I'm accepting money, I should provide the option to accept money by these modes also. And if I don't provide, then there is a we can say non-compliance of section 269SU, and in that case penalty would be imposable. So this is this section is already covered in penalty chapter. But what are those other prescribed modes? Debit card powered by rupee is that Indian like Visa, MasterCard, we have rupee. So debit card powered by that. Then UPI, Bheem UPI. UPI is unified payment interface. So I hope you know that Bheem UPI. Generally, when you make payment, this is through UPI. So there's another app, like we have Paytm, PhonePe and all. And there is one more app called as Bheem. So if a payment can be made by that. Or UPI, QR code. That is Bheem UPI QR code. So what is the full form of that? Unified Payments Interface Quick Response Code. So these are the other electronic modes. So in addition to prescribed electronic modes, we are going to study a lot of them. In addition to that, these modes should also be provided. Now at multiple places, we have studied that the payment should not be made by mode other than. So what are the four modes allowed? Account pay check, account pay draft, ECS and other prescribed electronic modes. So where we have this provision? Section 35AD. 35AD deduction won't be allowed if payment in excess of 10,000 is made in other than four modes. Then 40A33A, that cash payment. Cash payment limit is 10,000 and for that transport operator 35,000. So if the payment is exceeding 10,000 or 35,000, then it has to be paid by four modes. Then 43(1), that is relating to fixed assets. So if I have purchased fixed asset and I make payment in excess of 10,000 by other than four modes, then that won't be added to the actual cost and depreciation won't be allowed. Then 44AD, for 44AD also 6% rate, that it has to be paid by four modes on or before the income tax return due date, then 6%, otherwise 8%. Then 43C and 50C, this is for that immovable property. What is given in that? 50C is for capital assets and 43CA is for stock in trade. So if immovable property is sold, then in that case, if stamp duty value exceeds 105% of the sale price, then stamp duty value will be the consideration. There we have studied that date of agreement and SDV as on the date of agreement and SDV as on the date of registration. So when it will be SDV, when we will be taking SDV as on the date of agreement, when the part or full payment is received by mode other than or by received by four modes. What are the four modes? Account pay check, account pay draft, ECS and other electronic prescribed electronic modes. Then in that case, and it is received on or before the agreement date, then we can take SDV as on the date of agreement, otherwise date of registration. Similarly for 56 to 10 also, gift, same provision apply. Then 80JJAA, relating to that, this is favorite question of institute. So I'll request you that at least for 10 times you read this section. This is from chapter 6A. Every time in either 14 marks problem or 16 marks, whatever big problem is asked, one adjustment relating to this is already always there. So this is a section which keeps on updating every year. It gets on amended and institute also has, like, this is my favorite section. So every time there is an adjustment, at least for 10 times, you read that section and solve few problems on that. So here also, that payment should be received by other by specified modes, four modes. Then for 13A, that is political party, then 269SS, 269ST and 269T. Here also, it should be received by four modes. So what is that other prescribed modes for all these purposes? So in that case, other prescribed modes are credit card, debit card. So this is how to remember. This is card related. Then net banking, RTGS, NEFT and IMPS. This is net banking related. So net banking means online from one bank account, or you are having a bank account in HDFC. One bank account of HDFC to other. That is net banking. Then from that HDFC account to Union Bank account, that is NEFT, RTGS or IMPS. IMPS is immediate payment service. NEFT is National Electronic Funds Transfer. RTGS is real-time gross settlement. And last one is that UPI, that is Unified Payment Interface, means our all these different apps through which we make payment, Paytm, then Phone Pay, Google Pay, that is UPI, and Bheem, that is Bharat Interface for Money, Aadhaar Pay. So how to remember these other prescribed modes for all these sections? Three categories. First is cards related, second is net banking online related, and third is apps related. So card related, two, debit card, credit card. Then online related, three, or online related, four. Net banking, that means banking a transfer within same bank, if there are two accounts in the bank, and if it is to other bank, then NEFT, RTGS and IMPS. And apps related is UPI, Unified Payment Interface, or Bheem Aadhaar Pay. Bheem full form is Bharat Interface for Money. So maybe in exam they will ask, and how they'll ask, they won't ask that what are the prescribed modes. They'll give that, for example, here amount paid by Bheem app or Bheem that whatever payment is made, 40,000. So that is allowed. So no disallowance in that case. So one of the adjustment in PGBP problem number first problem, which is for around 14 marks, we'll have some adjustment relating to this prescribed payments. Then transfer pricing, this time limit for repatriation of excess money. So this already was there for May 2020 exam, and it is again repeated here. Okay, now many people had issues while calculating interest. So from 2nd September onwards, every day from at 5 p.m. 5 to 5:30, we are going to solve MCQs. So today is 31st. Yes, it's 31st August. So tomorrow we are going to do IDT related amendments. And from, so tomorrow is 1st September. And from 2nd September onwards, we are going to do MCQs, both DT IDT, from ICA MCQs, then from what else is it? Mock papers, RTP. So mock paper and RTP for May 2020 has two problems, one each, relating to this calculation of interest. Relating to this, what is this? I think that repatriation of money for primary adjustment, that secondary adjustment related. So many students keep on asking how to calculate at all. There are extremely complicated problems, MCQs in mock paper and RTP. So we will be solving all of them. You need not worry. So this amendment was already there for last exam. So I'm not repeating it, but numerical problems on this I'm going to take in MCQ tests or MCQ videos. Okay. Then this, here also there was 92D, which is relating to, so two amendments are there. This 92D is that master file, that country by country report and master file. So this master file, okay, so this rule 10DA, they have given threshold limit. So this threshold limit is also same, that 500 rupees consolidated group revenue, then value of international transaction during accounting year should exceed 50 crores, or in respect of purchase sale relating to immovable intangible property should exceed 10 crore, etc. So what is the amendment? They have given the form number. So not great amendment. And they have given list of documents to be kept or information to be kept. And due date for that is, okay, they have also specified who is the officer who is going to accept that. The officer is joint commissioner as designated by Director General of Income Tax Risk Assessment on or before income tax return due date. And you can just go through that. And this 10DB, there is also one small amendment, and that amendment is who is the officer who is going to accept that. So officer would be joint commissioner as designated by Director General of Income Tax Risk Assessment. And due date for that 286 is that country by country report. For that would be 2 months prior to 12 months from the end of relevant reporting year. Many students face issues in this also, this part. So in transfer pricing revision video, this is already covered. In this, there is not great amendment as such. Here they have just specified which is the officer who is going to accept that. So I request that you just go through this, and which form number. So form number also may not be relevant. What is relevant is what exactly is master file and what exactly is country by country report. So please go through the transfer pricing revision video. Then, so that ends. This was paper 7, amendments which are applicable for both old and new syllabus. What about paper 6C? This is, so this is international taxation paper 6C, same amendments. This time limit for repatriation of excess money. So this was already discussed for May 2020 exam. I told you that we are going to solve two problems on this, so that we are clear that how to calculate at interest. Then there is this tax payable. Tax is also payable on secondary adjust, that whatever excess money is there, and then after that interest would apply. So we will cover those two cases. And this again 92D master file related amendment, and country by country reported report related amendment. So not many amendments in DT. Whatever 4-5 amendments are there, we have discussed in detail. You can expect one problem based on that, or in 14 marks problem, some adjustment relating to that. Otherwise, DT, whatever was there for May 2020 exam, same will continue. Those who have opted for our regular or fast track video lectures, whatever lectures were there, same will apply. Just 4-5 amendments are there. After watching this video, please write down whatever I was discussing. I hope you have written down. And then that's it. So tomorrow we'll be again meeting for IDT amendments. IDT amendments are also like this. I'll be telling you references that where I've already discussed, and other provisions. we will be doing. Done for today. See you tomorrow.